Well, how are you this morning? Blessed, of course. Praise God. We're always blessed. Amen. Because God is faithful, God is gracious, God is merciful upon us. There is a story of a mother one Sunday morning went to her son's room. Waking up, hey mom, son, wake up. Why mom, it's Sunday. We need to go to church. Well, give me a few more minutes. And then keep nagging and waking up her son. And then say, son, wake up. It's church day. And son asks his mom, mom, give me a good reason why I should go to church. You are the pastor. You are the pastor. Did it ever occur to you that sometimes you are dragging your feet to go to church? You see, people, diba? There were days that sometimes you don't just want to go to church. You are like, you don't want to get up of bed. You don't want to dress up. You don't want to eat breakfast and get ready for church. There are days like those, and I'm telling you, as a pastor, it can happen to anyone like me. There were days that I was dragging my feet. But again, it will just be momentary, because we know the reason why we got together. We know the reason why we come to church. We know the reason why we are here. Amen? Just imagine, we are meeting up with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I'm not saying that you cannot meet up God in your own room, in your own house, in your own place, but there's a reason why we are here, and that's what Hebrews 10 verses 23 and 24 is reminding us and encouraging us. Again, the author of Hebrews is unknown, but again, this speaks to you and to me. He's speaking to all believers, to you and to me. He says, let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering. We have a hope, living hope, and that is Jesus Christ. Christ in us, the hope of glory. We are waiting for the return of Christ, and while we are waiting, you know, if, for example, the Prime Minister of Canada will come to a certain place, you know, those people who are fans, not many more are fans of the Prime Minister, but if you are a fan of the Prime Minister, you will go to a place and wait. Wait anxiously, wait eagerly, wait happily. So let us hold fast the confession of hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful, and let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good work, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as in the manner of some, but exhorting one another so much the more as you see the day approaches. I don't know about you, but I am waiting eagerly for the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. Imagine all of this thing that we suffer from and see here on the face of the earth that are not good will be gone, will be done. Everything will be made right. And so we are awaiting for that blessed hope, the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. So while we're waiting, be excited. Like I said, when you meet the Prime Minister, you would run away eagerly. And we are waiting for the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. And so while we are waiting, today is part of waiting. Who knows, maybe in a moment the Lord will return. Or tomorrow, or next week, or next month. Nobody knows. But while we're waiting, let's get ourselves excited. Let's get ourselves busy praising God. And so that's why we are here today. We are here to stir up each other. You know, you're stirring me up in faith. You're encouraging me. You're encouraging one another when we see each other on a Sunday morning like this. Maybe some of us had a bad week, probably had a challenging week, but once we see the brethren, we get encouraged. Why? Because we see Christ in them. I don't know about you, but I see Christ in you. And that alone is a great encouragement. And my spirit is getting lifted up. It's time I see the brethren. Let's pray. Father God, Lord, thank you for today. This is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. We're getting some bonuses of great weather, oh God, these days, oh God, Lord, like summer weather, oh God, Lord. And with that, we give you the glory, honor, and praise, oh God, Lord. And even today, as we gather together, we are excited to meet with you, Jesus, oh God, Lord. Holy Spirit, thank you for your presence. As always, when we gather together, oh God, Lord, oh God, you always inhabit in the praises of your people. Your presence is in our midst, oh God. Each time we gather together with a pure heart, with a pure motive, oh God, why we are here, oh God, Lord. And Father, we commit to you this day. We commit to you everything that will transpire in this morning's gathering, oh God, Lord. From the beginning to the end, even right now, as I'm standing here in front, it is your Holy Spirit, oh God, Lord, who is leading me to pray, who is leading me, oh God. Even the announcement, oh God, Lord, we might see it as nothing, but it is something with you, oh God, because you're interested in everything we do, oh God, Lord. And so, Lord, Holy Spirit, take control, oh God, even in the announcement, in the activities that we will be announcing for the week, oh God, and the worship team to be led by the Polidan family, and of course, the word that I will be delivering, oh God, Lord. Everything, oh God, Lord, will be done accordingly as Holy Spirit will lead us this morning. Bring the people, oh God. Many people are still on their way here, oh God, Lord. Wherever they may be, oh God, whether they are planning to attend or not, Lord, be with them as well. We lift them up unto you, oh God, Lord. If they are traveling, protect them, oh God, Lord. If they are going somewhere or having a family gathering, be with them as well, oh God, Lord. After all, we're still a family, oh God, Lord, that is loving each other as you commanded us to do so. Father God, we commit to you again this service, oh God, Lord. Even our Sunday school, oh God, who will go to their room later on. Thank you for the teachers and volunteers, oh God, Lord, who are committed to teach our young children, oh God, in the knowledge of who you are. Even in giving, oh God, Lord, again, we give because you give first, God. We love because you love us first, oh God, Lord. And our giving, oh God, is just an act of worship to who you are and what you've done in our lives and what you are continuously promised to do in us and through us, oh God, Lord. And that, Lord, as we give, oh God, you will multiply, oh God, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord God. And we pray for wisdom and the leadership of this church to be. Spending the money that you have entrusted us, that may we continue to be good stewards of these resources, oh God, Lord. Bless your people as they give, oh God, Lord. Bless us now as we worship you, oh God, Lord, even as we go to our announcement, oh God, Lord, and we honor you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise God. So let's proceed to our announcement. Okay, important, if you receive the email from me a couple of times, that means you are a leader, and then we are requesting you to join us this afternoon, 5 p.m. at meeting room number 3. And this is nothing new to you. We've done in the past leaders evaluation. Of course, our goal is to see where we can do better. Our goal is to encourage one another. Our goal is to be a better servants of the Lord Jesus Christ. And of course, we address some challenges. We solicit inputs and suggestions, and again we pray together, and that is this afternoon from 5 p.m. We will provide a light dinner. Okay, please join us, the leaders. And next midweek service will be October 23rd, and the midweek service will be Pastor Mark. Again, as you are aware, we also leave a prayer request to the Lord together with the team. Your prayer request, please let us know. Okay? Your email or text or call or facility direct to my sister, Tess, and brother in that. What else do we have? And this Saturday, men's ministry meeting at 7:30 p.m. Host will be Pastor Mike, and I will be doing the exhortation, and followed by the women's ministry meeting at 9:30 a.m. Facilitator will be Sister Mary Victor, and the host will be Sister Seth David. Okay, you are invited. You are free. What else do you have? Next Sunday, October 27th, is the end of October. Wow. And worship leader will be Shannon, Brother Shannon Dula of prayer will be Brother K, Pastor Mike will be delivering the word, and the Magat and Ramos families will be doing the president. Tita Mila will be here. Very cool. And again, we always appreciate you giving to the words of God for the other Christian fellowship. And the Lord will bring it back to you more than you expect. Amen. Okay, one more very important announcement. You is also probably read my email a couple of times. Today and the next Sunday is membership renewal Sundays. Okay? As I've explained, we are under Pentecostal Assemblies of Canada Western Church District. That means we adopted the local church constitution, and as per constitution of the church should have an official membership list. And to make it official, you need to sign membership form. But again, as I explained, it is not mandatory. It's not a prerequisite for you to be part of this church family. If you opted not to sign the membership, it is fine. You are still part of the family. The membership form does not, if you are not signing up, it does not disqualify you from being a member. You are still part of this family. You are part of the BLF Christian family. But again, like I said, because we have the constitution to follow, we would like you to, we encourage you to sign up the membership. Okay? And right now, we have some forms at the back of Brother Rolly. If you are 18 years old and up, then I encourage you to sign up for membership. And, of course, one major reason also why we need to have a membership renewal, as you are aware, we are transitioning the leadership between me and Pastor Mike. Okay? Also, as per constitution, if the pastor will be replaced or will retire. For example, my case, okay, I am retiring in the senior pastorship of this church. I will continue to be servant of the Lord wherever the Lord will lead us. As you know, I explained that to you. But again, Pastor Mike was raised by the Lord within. The Lord has raised up Pastor Mike. And again, just to be compliant to our constitution, the congregation, the members of the church need to say yes to him. Okay? And I know you will just say yes to him. I'm confident of that. I'm confident of that you will say yes to Pastor Mike. And again, November 17 will be our plebiscite or vocation or election day where we will say yes to Pastor Mike. Pastor Bradley.
Pastor, you need to clarify that why you don't need to sign the form, the membership, in order to attend this church. However, for the purpose of voting, you do need to sign the membership in order to vote. Okay,
correct.
Not just for the for Pastor Mike, but any future voting requirement of the church. Unless you are a member of this church, you cannot vote.
Correct. That's it. Yeah. So the same thing in the secular. Okay, you have to be a registered voter, right? You need to vote elect for either a provincial election or a federal election. You need to be a registered voter. Otherwise, you cannot exercise the vote. And again, Pastor Mike,
would the form be per adult or per family?
No, per adult. 18 years old and up. Well, it can be a registered voter, a registered member, I mean. And then again, even though you're a member of yours, you can still opt out not to vote. We are not forcing you to vote. We're not putting a gun on you like, okay, you vote. Good. Okay, we exercise freedom and liberty. Okay? And so again, my encouragement to you, first of all, is to sign up the membership form. And of course, you can read the form and see how you find it. And attached to the membership form is the SOFET, or Statement of Faith and Essential Truths. And I don't want you to sign up the memorandum without reading it, because it explains what we believe. Okay, it explains to you the doctrinal belief that the church are adhering to. Okay? And if you have questions, please do not hesitate to approach me, Pastor Mike, Brother Kane, Brother Nell, Brother Jojo. These are the pastoral team who can guide you through this membership form. And again, not mandatory, okay? You are still part of this family, okay? So, I hope that we made it clear, okay? Father and Lord, again, thank you. Thank you that today we have got it together in the presence of that Lord, that Holy Spirit is so present in our midst, and we ask you, Lord, now to guide us in everything that will transpire, even our Sunday school, in our giving, in our worship of God, even the registration of membership of God, Lord, here at the Christian Fellowship, and Lord, God is my thing, Holy Spirit, we commit you everything. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Let's worship the Lord.
Good morning. Shall we all stand? Amen. Before we worship our Lord, let us greet one another. Let's go around and exchange warm smile and just say
bye.
Hi. And let's say, oh, I love you with the love of the Lord. Many reasons we can rejoice daily. Amen. Church, today God made this day for you and me.
Amen.
Amen. So let's rejoice because we know God will make something new in our life. Amen. There's no weapon formed against us shall prosper. Amen.
Amen.
So church, I encourage you, I invite you to clap your hands, to worship our God, to give your all to Him because it's all about Him. Amen.
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 Thank you.
Thank you. pray so, Father God, hallelujah. Jesus, we thank you, O Lord God, for your sacrifice on the cross. We thank you, O Father God, for redeeming us from sin, O Lord God. You alone, O Father God, is the source of salvation, O Father God. You alone, Father God, holds the ultimate power and authority above all things. Amen.
Amen.
And Lord God, we worship you, O Father God, because your name is above all name, and you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
Amen.
Hallelujah. We will continue to glorify your name, O Father God. We will continue to give you praise and honor, O Father God, because you alone deserve it, O Lord God. Hallelujah.
Beautiful Savior, Thank you.
one goal. That is to give you glory, to honor you, to praise you, to magnify your name, to thank you for who you are. The week could be very challenging to some of us, Lord, but nevertheless, you are faithful. You're the same yesterday, today, forever. Whether good or bad, you are there. You are good. You're not affected with anything in this world. You're still seated on the throne of heaven, looking down unto us, Lord Jesus, continuously interceding for us. Holy Spirit is here with us, guiding us, leading us, protecting us, providing for our needs. It is you alone, Jesus. Honor and glory is yours only, Jesus. And so today, Lord, thank you. Thank you, God, for this day. Thank you for the sunshine. Thank you for the air that we breathe. Thank you for the water that we drink. Thank you for the food that we eat. Thank you for the clothes that we wear. Thank you for this, the friends that we have. Thank you for the family that we have. Thank you for this church. Thank you for the big body of church believers around the world, God. Thank you. And today, Lord, thank you for that you have a message for us, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Holy Spirit, we ask you now to speak your word through me, Lord. I'm your mouthpiece. I'm your servant, O God, to deliver your word today. And I pray, Lord, that people will have the excitement, the readiness to hear what you have to say. Holy Spirit, we commit you everything, Lord. Have your way, Holy Spirit. In your name we pray.
Amen.
Praise God. Please be seated, and our Sunday school will proceed to the room. Summer still, the weather is just like some, praise God. Amen. Of course, nobody's ready yet for winter. God, I know. Praise God. Well, we are sprinting our way to almost the end of our series, Romans Road to Redemption. 2 Sundays ago, I preached on one of the most controversial chapters in this epistle, in Romans chapter 7, especially when Paul called himself carnal and a wretched man. But in today's study, we will find out the confidence Paul had, and our confidence as well, as we journey together in this challenging life on earth, and yet with so much hope and assurance of immovable position you and I have in Christ Jesus. So I entitled my preaching today as Life in the Spirit. Life in the Spirit, and our passage for today is from Romans 8, 1 to 11. So please stand with me as we read our passage for today. And we're reading from New King James Version. Romans 1, 8, 1 to 11. Okay, let's read. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh on account of sins. He condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace, because the carnal mind is enmity against God. For it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can be. So then those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his. And if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through His Spirit who dwells in you. Let's pray. Father God, again, thank you for your word. Your word is pure and holy and righteous, O God, Lord, and we ask you, the Holy Spirit, to illuminate it so that we can understand what you are to say to us, O God, Lord. And we commit to you everything. In your name we pray.
Amen.
Please be seated. So for today's preaching, I have this big idea, okay? The big idea is this. Every true believer, okay? Every true believer is under no obligation to agree with the flesh when it wants to do something bad and sin against God. But instead, we can live a life in the Spirit who made us free from sin and free to obey Him as well, right? So, you are a true believer, you are under no obligation to agree with your flesh, okay? So to begin with, let me share with you a synopsis and a context of chapter 8. So we can understand what we will be talking about, discussing about. So in chapter 8, Paul explains the very heart of the gospel message. This chapter has been an inspiration to Christians for over 20 centuries. Its verses have been quoted repeatedly by preachers, pastors, and plain believers alike as a source of hope and confidence. It begins with no condemnation and ends with no separation, if you read through the whole of chapter 8. And throughout the chapter, there is the theme of no defeat for the believers in Christ Jesus. Wow, I like that. I love that message, no defeat. Okay, don't you like that message? No condemnation, no separation, and no defeat. And that's what we will be talking about today. For several chapters, Paul wrote about the death of our sin and how the entire human race deserves God's condemnation. Human race deserves God's condemnation for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, Romans 3:23. Okay. And we've studied and learned that all of the law is good, and it is beneficial, and it is spiritual, but it cannot save us. It can only point us to our sin, but no power to overcome it. In fact, Paul wrote of his own struggle in the fight against the flesh, unashamedly admitting that he is carnal and wretched. You and I can also be carnal because of the flesh and come to a point of wretchedness. So Paul has urged the Christians in Rome to serve their new master. As we read in chapter 6, the new master is the Lord Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit. Amen. And to love their new husband, chapter 7. So here in chapter 8, Paul shows how the dreadful life of repeated defeat can be exchanged for a life of victory and joy and peace, because there's now no more condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Are you excited?
Amen.
Hallelujah. So in today's message, I will be sharing with you 3 points from our passage. And I will be talking about no condemnation, verse 1 to 4. We'll be talking about two mindsets, verses 5 to 8. And then the application part is life in the Spirit, verses 9 to 11. So let's proceed with point number 1, no condemnation. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death, for what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in likeness of sinful flesh on account of sin. He condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteous requirement below might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. The Greek word for condemnation is katakrima, which means adverse sentence, adverse judgment. And of course, in Bible school, we've been taught that when you say the word therefore, we need to find out why it is therefore. Okay? And the word therefore, in our study, the word therefore is very important in our study, as we need to know. Okay, like I said, we need to know why it's therefore. It is an adverb that links the previous ideas to what Paul is saying next. It bridges the principle from previous chapters to the new chapters that we've been discussed. So, Paul said, therefore, as a result, therefore, as a consequence of what he talked about in previous chapters, what did he talk about? That our sins has been dealt with by Jesus Christ on the cross, that we are now dead to sin and alive to God, and that we are no longer under the law, but under grace, has brought us to a new place where there is no more condemnation.
Amen.
So the previous chapters explain to us, and we come to a point of no condemnation because of what happened. I don't know about you, but this verse is the most reassuring verse of all the Bible after receiving Jesus Christ as my Savior and Lord. That I am no longer condemned, period. If I am in the court of law, that means I was declared not guilty. You are declared not guilty. So no condemnation, what does it mean? What does it mean? Because we were all born from Adam, we inherited his sin. Right? You heard that? You know that? And because of that, you don't need to commit sin to become sinner.
Amen.
Okay? You understand, right? You don't need to commit sin to become sinner. People are already sinners by birth before they even commit sin.
Amen.
People are already born with sinful nature. And as a result, all people born of Adam are under condemnation.
Amen.
All people who are born of Adam are under condemnation and separated from God, like Adam was separated from God. But Paul explains that those who have believed in Christ are now positionally in Him. They are justified or declared righteous by grace through the redemption in Christ, and they are now alive in Christ Jesus. So Paul emphasized that the one believing in Jesus now has a new identity in Christ, and our identity is Jesus Christ. We're Christians and has become children of God. So, where there was once condemnation by God, there is now justification through Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. There's now no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus, but the word no condemnation is incomplete, meaning incomplete by itself, if the phrase to those in Christ Jesus is not added to it. Okay. So what did Paul mean to those in Christ Jesus? Folks, there are two ways to live our life here on earth. Either you are believer or unbeliever, okay? You can live in yourself. You can live in your own ability. You can live in your own understanding. You can do it your way. You can live in your own power. And just like the Apostle Paul, who ended up in frustration in defeat and ended up in wretched state of mind, we too can fall into a state of wretchedness and we need to be delivered from it. So, what did Paul really mean in his prayer to those in Christ Jesus? And Paul has a great lessons for us to learn from him. It means a place of being and a place to be, a place to live, a place to think, a place of awareness that our lives must be centered in Christ and in him alone.
Amen.
Remember, it's all about Jesus.
Amen.
It's all about him. It's all about him. In Christ Jesus means that he is in us and we are in him. When we accept the Jesus Christ Savior, he instantaneously lives in us through the Holy Spirit. That means he is in us, but more importantly, we are in him. Let us not settle for the fact that Christ is in us, but also to the truth that we are in him. The scripture tells us that we die to Christ. We die and our life is now hidden with Christ in God. Colossians 3:3. In Christ Jesus, there is synergy. What did I mean by that? 100% of God in us, and if we cooperate, 100% of us. It's not 50-50. Okay? 100% of Christ in us. There's synergy, there's togetherness, there's oneness, and there's no separation. It is the fullness of Christ in us, but it is always up to us if we give 100% of us in him. But God, Jesus Christ, will never give us a portion only of him. He gives us 100% of him in us. In Christ, we live and move and have our being. In Christ, we are free. In Christ, we are secured. In Christ, it is not just Christ in us, but we're in Christ, and that's a place where there's no more condemnation. Jesus is our advocate. In the court of law, God plays the triune roles for you and for me. In the court of law, and how is that? God is the judge, Holy Spirit is a witness, and Jesus Christ is a lawyer. Don't you love that? Triune role, God the Father is the judge, Holy Spirit is a witness, and Jesus is our lawyer. Satan is the prosecuting lawyer. Okay? Romans 8:31 tells us that if God is for us, who can be against us? No one can be against us because God is with us and God is for us. Amen? Hallelujah. See, God the Father cannot and will not condemn his son Jesus Christ. So when God sees us in Christ, who are you? I'm Michael Rogiza. Are you in Christ? Yes, I'm in Christ, therefore you're not condemned. That's how God treats the believers. He sees Jesus Christ in us, therefore, there's now no more condemnation. In Christ Jesus is a place of safety, a place of security, and a place of no condemnation. Now, in verses 2 to 4, Paul said, "For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh on account of sin. He condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteous requirement below might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh but according to the Spirit." So Paul mentioned here two laws that are in effect here on the earth. And those are the law of spirit of life and the law of sin and death. So let's look at both to understand what Paul is talking about. Okay. In mentioning that these two laws, Paul is explaining why we came to a point of no condemnation. Okay. That's his point of view. He presented it so we will understand why we came to a point of no condemnation. Since the fall of Adam, there was the law that exists and still in existence even in our world today. Remember, God said to Adam, in the day you eat from the tree of good and evil, you will surely die. Genesis 2:7. And the law is called the law of sin and death. The law of sin and death. Okay? See that? Before the cross, there is already existing law. That is the law of sin and death. Okay? So what is it? What is the law of sin and death? The law of sin and death is the Old Testament laws of God. The law is holy. We know that the law is holy, just and good. Romans 7:12. But because no one can keep the law on our own, on your own, the result is only sin and death for those who are under the law. Okay. Now, though this law exists and in effect, but when Jesus came and died and rose again from the dead, his sacrificial death on the cross overruled this law with a most powerful and effective law, which Paul called the law of spirit and life. Okay? This new law did not remove the old law. It coexists on the earth. There's still the law of sin and death, but there's a more powerful law, which is the law of spirit and life. That's after the cross. You can see that? At Jesus' death and resurrection, okay? Overruled. Okay, the spirit of death and life. This new law did not eradicate the old law, but it coexisted with it. But those who are under the new law were freed from the law of sin and death. So it's like same as saying the believers are now under the new management. So what is the law of spirit and life? The law of spirit and life is the gospel or good news of Jesus Christ, the message of new life through faith in the resurrected Christ. It defines the law of sin and death through the sacrificial death of Jesus on the cross. How many of you here, most of us probably ride an airplane, right? We flew from one place to another in an airplane, right? Have you ever wondered how and why airplanes can fly and stay in the air as long as it needs to? But, Pastor, there's about the law of gravity. What is the law of gravity? Everything that goes up must come down. The law of gravity. Now, but how can an airplane fly and reach its destination? Airplanes can fly because of the new law that defines the law of gravity is called the law of aerodynamics or the law of lift and thrust, okay? To be more specific, the law of lift and thrust, law of aerodynamics. So, the law of gravity still exists. So don't ever assume that the law of gravity no longer exists because airplane can fly. If you want to try it, jump over the building and find out. But don't. Okay. The law of gravity still exists, but the law of aerodynamic defines it or overpowers it. So in the same manner, the law of sin and death is overpowered by a much powerful law, the law of spirit and life. You can give him praise. Hallelujah. Amen. Actually, Paul presented this law in perspective in Romans 6:23. What did he say? He said that for the wages of sin is death. Law of sin and death, right? But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus, which the law of spirit and life. The law of spirit and life overpower the wages of sin, the law of sin and death. Jesus Christ overpowers the sin and death, which is the law of spirit and life in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. The law of God were powerless to save anyone, but the cross of Christ is powerful to save and redeem anyone who comes to Him in faith. So point number two mindsets. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace, because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can be. So then those who are in the flesh cannot please God. Believers are no longer under the law. You know that, right? But through Christ Jesus, we under grace. Under grace. I end with Brother Mark. He's always under grace. We are under grace. Thus we should seek to live in a way that expresses gratitude to God for the salvation provided by His Son. Unfortunately, there are some Christians who live their lives that doesn't show much difference than how they lived before coming to Christ. Why? Well, because of God's grace. Well, the grace of God will forgive me. The grace of God will get me through this. They use the grace of God. The principle of God's grace becomes an excuse to continue living the way they want to live, allowing the flesh to rule them. And that's what Paul addressed in chapter 7, isn't it? He addressed that problem that he said, "Oh wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this? But praise be to God who delivered me from this." He knew the answer. He knew the solution to his wretchedness. He knew the counteraction to the flesh. It means that the true Christians who daily seek God and have their life fully surrendered to the Holy Spirit should no longer have the desire to live contrary to God. Can daily communing, daily cooperating, daily seeking God. To have their life fully surrendered to the Holy Spirit should no longer have the desire to live contrary to God's will, but instead to have divine holiness, righteousness, and goodness fulfilled in them. Because we have the dwelling of the Holy Spirit in each of us, we should all desire to live according to the Spirit's prompting. But here's an interesting twist in this passage. Paul, in verse 5 to 8, goes on to present two markers or two checkpoints we need to look for to see where we are at. This is a checkpoint for you and for me. Am I truly a believer, or am I not? Are we in Christ or are we not? So Paul presented the essential difference between those who live after the flesh, meaning not in Christ, and those who live after the Spirit, and those who are in Christ. And those who set their minds on the things of the flesh, or those who set their minds on things of the Spirit. So what did Paul mean with that? So let me present to you two mindsets that Paul's talking. Number one is flesh mind, or living by the flesh. Living by the flesh. Let me be honest with you, it was a very hard study for me. I had a difficulty. But again, praise the Lord. But the book of Romans is indeed a deep theological source if we need to understand the very core of our salvation through Christ Jesus. So read. Pay attention to the books of Romans. So at this point, Paul is differentiating two kinds of people, the saved ones, those who live according to the flesh, and the saved one, those who live according to the Spirit. And who are these people? Who are these people who live according to the flesh? The key word is live. That's why I take note, live. Okay, the key word is live. Okay? Those who are alive, they breathe. Okay? So those people living in the flesh breathe according to the flesh, and their fruit is of the flesh. Okay? These people continue to live in enmity to God and in opposition to His holy will. They remain a part of this present crooked and perverse generation of this world and desires no other. I like how one preacher described these people. He said, these people are drawn to sin like metal shavings to a magnet. If you try that, using a magnet, anything that's metallic would... Okay. And that's who they were. Like the sin, it's like a magnet to them. Okay? So the taste of flesh are the object of their desire, attention, and pursuit. And Paul described their works, the works of the flesh in Galatians 5, 19 to 21. He said, now the works of the flesh are evident, sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissension, disputes, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like this. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Clear enough, right? So, but in my study, I look into Bible Hub. I use Bible Hub once in a while. And it is interesting to look at how Bible Hub did a text analysis of Romans 5:8. That's this text. He said, for according to the flesh being, the things the flesh mind. Okay? Those, however, according to the Spirit, the things the Spirit. And by the way, the Greek word for live is ontes, okay? Which means being, or I am, or exist. So, it can mean I am flesh, being flesh, or exist as flesh. If you do the translation, right? Okay, so, a flesh being with a flesh mind makes a person spiritually dead and unable to live a fruitful life, spiritual fruitful life. He cannot please God, nor does he have desire to do so. He is self-centered and cannot submit to God. He will only answer to his own desires and oppose any submission to God. And of course, the result is eternal separation from God. So, my prayer as I am preaching this is that none of you would see yourself and say, oh yeah, that was me. Okay? But if so, there's good news for you. Just hang on a little bit later. Okay? Hang in there. But in contrast, Paul tells us those who are in Christ Jesus, which is a spirit mind or someone who's living in the spirit. And here's the flip side of the coin in verse 5b and 6b. Paul said, but those who live according to the spirit, the things of the spirit, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. So who are the spirit-minded people Paul were referring to? If you're in Christ Jesus, then Paul is talking to you. If you have Christ Jesus, Paul is referring to you, to me, and to all of those who are believers of Christ Jesus. So, Paul said in verse 10, if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the spirit is life because of righteousness. What did Paul exactly mean by it? These are the believers who live according to the Spirit, who has been regenerated by the Holy Spirit and has learned to hate sin, has learned to confess sin and trust that his salvation has been secured by the sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross. As one of the redeemed, the Christian is led by the Spirit to pursue the things that are of the Spirit. These people are not, that they don't just hate sin, but they flee from it and works to keep himself away from it. Did you ever hate someone, but still, I mean, forgive me for using the word hate, okay? But did you ever hate someone, but still hanging out with that person? It doesn't make sense, right? You try to stay away from that person, okay? And this is what Paul meant. If you hate sin, you don't even want to be near sin. You don't want to do anything with sin and anything that can make you commit sin. I'm not saying these people won't sin anymore. I'm not saying that we should be living a sinner's perfection. We can't. No one can. But you are making a conscientious effort to stay away that will make you sin. But those are people who are sensitive to the prompting of the Holy Spirit in their life with the discernment between right and wrong, and makes the decision to obey the voice of the Spirit in their life. In faith, the believers grow in his love for God, God's Word. Not just for God's Word, but for God's people. And they love to be in God's house. And they love to promote the things of God's kingdom. Okay? His spiritual orientation and desires to be more and more conformed to Christ Jesus. Knowing that there's no more condemnation for these people, they live a peaceful life. Now, can you identify yourself with that? That I'm describing? Again, I hope you do. And again, if you are not, you cannot identify yourself, there's good news for you. Hang on. Okay. So, Paul said in verse 9b, and this is the test. Now, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his. He is not his. Are you with Christ? Is the Holy Spirit of Christ is in you? So if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his. Remember, when you accepted Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit will be in you instantaneously. So Paul, speaking to Galatians, contrasting the works of the flesh, I presented that link earlier, contrasting the works of the flesh versus the fruit of the Spirit by saying this, Galatians 5, 20-23, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. And those who are Christ, and crucified the flesh with his passion and desires. So, the evidence of the tree is in the fruit, right? An apple tree must only bear an apple. An orange tree must only bear an orange. Without the fruit, no one can really tell what the tree are. Jesus said in John 15:5, I don't have that. Jesus said in John 15:5, I am the vine. What is it? You are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. Okay? So, if you are connected to the vine, if you are an apple tree, you bear apple. You're connected to the vine, if you are an orange, you bear orange. Are you saved? The question is, are you saved? Are you dwelt by the Holy Spirit? Are you his? Are you bearing the fruit of the Holy Spirit? And now we will proceed to point number 3. Life in the Spirit. Said, but you're not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. Indeed, the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, it's not his. And if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. But the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you. He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. Reading a couple of commentaries on chapter 8, both writers said that this chapter can be called the ministry of the Holy Spirit chapter. Why? Because Holy Spirit was mentioned at least 20 times, and you know what? I counted it myself. Yeah, is it really true? I counted at least 20. And we all know that salvation is the pure work of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit convicts sinners and is the one who gives them faith and courage to come to Him in repentance. Holy Spirit is our deliverer. Holy Spirit is the third person of the Godhead that brought us to a place of no condemnation. Holy Spirit is now living inside of us. Jesus said before ascension, I need to go so that the Holy Spirit can come upon you. Therefore, here is now the test. When the rubber meets the road, how are you living your life as a born-again believer? So verse 9, is a transitional verse when Paul switched back the direction towards his reader. His reader was the saints in Rome. And if you are born again believer, then Paul is speaking back to you and to me. He said, but you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if it is me, okay, talking, if it's me who wrote this, this is what I would say. What's wrong with you? Don't you understand you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit? And because you're now in the Spirit, that means your body of sin is now dead. Don't revive it. Don't bring it back. So Paul said, but you're not in the flesh, but the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who has the Spirit of God has become a new creation in Christ Jesus, 2 Corinthians 5:17. The old is now gone and everything becomes new. So flesh and spirit are two of the main powers belonging to the old self and the new self, respectively. By God's grace in Christ, Christians have been taken out of the realm dominated by flesh and placed us in the realm dominated by God's Holy Spirit. Now the question is, how does life in the Spirit look like then? This is the application now. Repeatedly, we all heard that believers have the indwelling Spirit in Christ, the Comforter who proceeds from the Father. But Paul said in verse 11, but if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, He who raised Jesus Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through Spirit who dwells in you. Friends, do you realize how much power that is in you? Do you realize how powerful the one who's living inside of you, in us? It is God's power, the omnipotent power of God, the creator power, the savior's power, the healing power, the redeemer's power, the comforter's power, the resurrection power is inside of you, inside of me. Therefore, we can live in the Spirit. And how does it look like? Alive in the Spirit is a prayer for life. For Holy Spirit, help us in prayer. How is your prayer life, if I may ask? It is also a life of intercession, as He leads us to pray for one another in accordance to the will of God. And we all heard that Christian life is a journey. And because it's a journey, we need to walk in it. So when we read the word walk in the Bible, it's often a metaphor for practical daily living. Okay? So, a life in the Spirit is one who makes progress in that walk. Galatians 2:25, Paul reminds, if we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. So how does a life in the Spirit look like? A life in the Spirit is when your life is totally, fully surrendered to God. He's not your co-pilot. He's not your co-pilot. He is your pilot. And you are His passenger enjoying the ride. Don't grab the steering wheel. Lord Jesus, let me help you. He doesn't need your help. He knows what He's doing. What does life in the Spirit looks like? A spirit, life in the Spirit, always living in humility. For humility goes hand in hand with fearing the Lord and doing what He commands. A life in the spirit is a life that yields to his control, his lead, and allowing him to exert his influence over us. And those who walk in the spirit are united with him and are bearers of the fruit of the spirit he produces. And the final thought, living the spirit is bearing the fruit, Galatians 5, 22-23. That means a person who lives in the spirit lives in love. Love for God and love for others. A person who lives in spirit and lives in joy. One who exhibits gladness in what God has done and what God is doing and what God will do. A person who lives in spirit and lives in peace, their lives are defined by not defined by worry or anxiety. A life in the spirit is lives in kindness. Patience. They are forgiving and not short-tempered people. A life in the spirit lives in kindness. They show deep, sincere concern for the need of others. A life in the spirit lives in goodness. Their actions reflect virtue and holiness. A life in the person lives in spirit lives in faithfulness. They are steadfast in their trust in God and his word. A person who lives in spirit lives with gentleness. Their life is characterized by humility, grace, and thankfulness to God. And lastly, a person who lives in spirit lives with self-control. They display moderation, constraint, and ability to say no to the flesh. Now, in conclusion, how are we going to relate this to you, to me? How will I relate this thing to me? Number one, if you're not in Christ, you are condemned already by God, John 3:18. Okay? Remember we talked about those before the cross? People were condemned. So right now, if you're not in Christ, you are condemned already by God. But there's still hope for you. You're still living. You're still alive today. Therefore, there's still hope for you. You need to be in Christ. Remember, in Christ Jesus, so that you can be in a position of no condemnation. For only in Christ we can be forgiven, so that Holy Spirit can dwell inside of you. Number two, Paul presented us a couple of checkpoints. Are you living according to the flesh, which is dictated by the flesh, and is the flesh dominant over your life? If so, then you need to switch your allegiance from the flesh to the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit is in you, Christ is in you, therefore there's now no more condemnation for you. And lastly, it does not end there. The true evidence of Holy Spirit indwelling in you is when you bear the fruit that God produces in and through you. Therefore, live in the Spirit of God, allow Him to rule and reign over your life. Amen. Let us pray. Father God, thank you, God, for today. Thank you for your word, for your Holy Spirit, for speaking to us those truths of God. And Lord, we give to you the rest of this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thanks so much. Thank you. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Pastor Rick. That's a wonderful theological sermon. And Romans 8:1-11, the first 11 verses reminds us that those who are in Christ, there's no condemnation. And it's not just a theological thing, but it's a reality that we could experience. That liberating mindset that there's no condemnation for you. Those who are in Christ, and as we all know, the spirit and the flesh, there's still an ongoing battle between the spirit and the flesh. And I love what Pastor Rita says earlier, that the Holy Spirit is in us, but the question is, are we in the spirit? Are we living in the life of the Spirit, and that's the only way that we could have that victorious life. When we allow the Holy Spirit to lead us, when we allow the Holy Spirit to work into our lives, when we allow the Holy Spirit to be the master of our lives, besides that one, we will not have a victorious life. Remember John 10:10, Jesus says, I come so that you will have a life in the fullest. And that's the very reason that he came, he sent his Holy Spirit to each one of us so we'll have that victorious life. Friends, the Spirit gives us the strength to overcome sin and to embrace a new life we have given. So let us not be passive recipients, but rather we should be active participants. Amen? Amen. So why don't we all stand up as we wrap up this gathering. Hallelujah. Would you pray with me? Hallelujah. Father God, we thank you for the powerful message that you have spoken to your servant, Pastor Rick Lorica. Thank you once again for reminding us that there is no condemnation of those who are in Christ Jesus. And reminding us that we already have a new life, that we shouldn't be going back to the life of sin because we are a new creation. And Lord, we thank you for the Advocate. We thank you for the Counselor. We thank you for the Holy Spirit that you have deposited to each one of us, because he is the key for the victorious life, Lord Jesus. So Lord, help us every day, Lord God, to live the life in the Spirit, Lord God. Help us, Lord God, that the message of hope, the message of grace, the message of the gospel, Lord God, would not just end in us, Lord God, but rather we would share it to others, Lord God, because those who are in Christ, there won't be any condemnation, Father God. And finally, now may the God of grace, who set you free from condemnation to Christ Jesus, fill you with his Spirit in the newness of life. May the peace that surpasses all understanding be with you and fill your heart. Go forward in the power of the Holy Spirit, living in his love and reflecting his glory to the world around you. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and everyone says, Amen. 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 Thank you so much. Thank you for joining us, and we'll see you next week once again.